So today we are going to discuss the atmospheric origin, composition and structure. So that is how the atmosphere came into existence, how it got formed, what are the gases, solids and liquids comprising it, and third is structure of atmosphere. What are the various layers that make up the atmosphere? So atmosphere origin, composition and structure. So basically, before beginning with this, I must tell you that just like lithosphere and hydrosphere, atmosphere is also integral part of the earth. Atmosphere is not separable. As the earth rotates, the atmosphere also rotates along with the earth. So just like lithosphere and hydrosphere, the atmosphere of earth is also the integral part of it. And it is merely because of atmosphere that the life is possible on earth. Basically, the atmosphere contains certain greenhouse gases, and these gases do not allow the extremes of temperature on earth, gases and vapors. Basically, in the absence of atmosphere, the difference between the temperature of day and night would have been 260 degrees centigrade. That would have rendered life impossible on planet. It is because of the atmospheric gases which absorb the heat and release the heat that the extremes of temperature are avoided. And moreover, it is because of atmosphere that hydrosphere is existing on Earth's surface. All the seas would have evaporated just like they have in Mars. On the planet Mars, there is no water. Why? Because the atmosphere is absent. It is the atmospheric pressure that raises the boiling point. And basically, it is because of atmospheric pressure that the boiling point is 100 degrees centigrade. So the water is not evaporating. If we reduce the atmosphere, for example, in Mars, the boiling point is minus 3 degrees centigrade. If atmospheric pressure decreases, the boiling point decreases. That is the reason in hilly areas, when we move up, the atmospheric pressure decreases. And in hilly areas, boiling point is much less than what is witnessed in plains. Basically, you might have started in 8th and 9th class that the boiling point decreases with increasing elevation, therefore pressure cookers are important. So what happens? It is because of atmosphere. If atmosphere is removed, then the boiling point may become minus 3 degrees centigrade. It is because of atmospheric pressure. It is because of atmospheric pressure that the boiling point is high. And that is because the hydrosphere is existing on Earth and it is absent on Mars. Mars does not have any atmosphere. In the absence of atmosphere, the boiling point is very low. It is minus 3. So water gets evaporated even at minus 3 on Mars. So basically, atmosphere serves a very important another purpose, that the gases that atmosphere has, like oxygen and carbon dioxide, these gases are so much required for the prevalence of life on this planet. It is because of carbon dioxide that plants do photosynthesis, and it is because of oxygen that man and animals are able to live. Apart from this, the atmosphere surrounding the earth serves yet another very important function, that is, it acts as a protective wall. It acts as a protective wall which surrounds the planet against all sorts of meteorites. The bombardment of meteorites is protected. Basically, these meteorites get burned when they enter into the atmosphere because of the friction. Atmosphere is also rotating around the earth. So when the meteors enter from space, they get burned down by the friction of atmosphere. So atmosphere serves several very important functions which usually go unnoticed. Otherwise, these are very important for the survival of life on earth. So few important parts: that extremes of temperature has been avoided, like basically carbon dioxide and oxygen gases, they have made the possibility of plants and animals to survive on this planet. And basically, it has ensured that the oceans are there, water is there. In the absence of atmosphere, all the water would have evaporated because of low boiling point. And above all, it acts as a protective layer that protects the earth from all sorts of bombardment from meteorites. Now, this was the significance. Now, origin. If we see the origin of atmosphere, what we see, initially when the earth got separated from sun, it was in the form of hot gaseous nebula. are first in the form of hot gaseous nebula. It was very hot and very rarefied. Gradually, when it cooled down, certain gases were ejected. During the process of cooling, certain gases were ejected from the earth. As this gaseous nebula was cooling down, certain gases were being ejected. Most important was water vapor. Water vapor comprised 70% of the total gases that were emanated during the process of cooling. Second important gas was carbon dioxide, that comprised 10 to 15%, and third was nitrogen, 8 to 10%. So these were the prominent gases that were ejected while the earth was undergoing cooling. Now scholars are of the view that the number of gases that got ejected were numerous, but these three were the most prominent. And scholars say the gases that were ejected during the cooling of earth were the same as are presently being ejected during volcanic eruption. Scholars say during volcanic eruption, during present time, those gases which are ejected, same gases were being ejected while the earth was cooling down. Initially, it was acquiring the solid state from the gaseous state. But these three gases are most important: water vapor, carbon dioxide, and nitrogen. Now, gradually, as this water vapor led to the formation of clouds, gradually the water vapor condensed and it led to the formation of clouds. And these clouds caused stupendous rainfall for thousands of years. These clouds caused stupendous heavy rainfall for thousands and lakhs of years. This rainfall further expedited the process of cooling. This rainfall further expedited the process of cooling. Moreover, this rainfall removed much of the water vapor from the atmosphere. As a result, this water vapor which was present in the atmosphere, it was hindering the process of cooling, because water vapor is a very efficient absorber of heat. And when the heat was being lost from the earth, basically the water vapor used to absorb it. Basically, this further reduced the rate of cooling. But when this water vapor got transformed into water, and basically large part of this water vapor got removed from the atmosphere by way of rainfall. One, falling drops of rain expedited the cooling, and they also removed the water vapor from atmosphere and brought it down to the earth's surface. And because of this removal of water vapor, more and more heat could be lost to space. Additionally, these falling drops of rain dissolved much of the carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide dissolved water, when it reached the earth's surface, it led to the formation of carbonate rocks. Carbon dioxide is also a greenhouse gas, and that was also hindering the process of cooling. So when much of the carbon dioxide was removed from the atmosphere and brought down onto the surface, the rate of cooling, rate of loss of heat further expedited, and the rate of cooling also expedited. Now, this carbon dioxide led to the formation of carbonate rocks on the earth. Now, this process continued. Now, scholars are of the view that oxygen, that is the most vital element for man. Basically, oxygen was initially absent in the atmosphere, and it is believed to have come at a subsequent date. It is said that this oxygen was the result of convective rise of water vapor. Scholars say that is because of heating, water was getting evaporated. As it was getting evaporated, or whatever water vapor was existing in the upper atmosphere, under the impact of UV radiation, that is ultraviolet radiation, this water vapor molecule was getting dissociated into hydrogen and oxygen. Under the impact of UV radiation, the water vapor that was getting evaporated by way of convective transport, or the tank water vapor that was previously existing in the atmosphere, this water vapor was impacted by ultraviolet radiation. As a result of impact of ultraviolet radiation, the water H2O was getting dissociated into hydrogen and oxygen. Hydrogen being lighter, it escaped to space, but oxygen atom remained behind and combined with another oxygen atom to form oxygen molecule. Yes, it is accepted that this has been one of the processes responsible for the formation of oxygen. That is, water vapor molecule getting dissociated to hydrogen and oxygen. Hydrogen being lighter, it escapes to space, and oxygen atom that remains behind, it combines with another oxygen atom to form oxygen molecule. But this process is so slow that it cannot account for the 21% of the oxygen that is found in the atmosphere. Oxygen accounts for 21% of the total gaseous mass. So basically oxygen is 21%. This process is so slow that it cannot explain the occurrence of 21% of oxygen. So there might have been some other process also responsible for the formation of oxygen. The another school of thought says that an important source of oxygen was the green plants. Green plants, during the course of photosynthesis, they release oxygen. But the issue here is that this theory believes the existence of green plants even before the existence of oxygen. And if we believe this theory says green plants basically during photosynthesis they release oxygen. But green plants also need oxygen to respire. So they cannot, this theory cannot explain the formation of oxygen before the oxygen was present, because green plant themselves require oxygen for the survival. Are you getting this? This theory states during photosynthesis, green plants release oxygen, but these green plants also require oxygen for respiration. If oxygen was not present from the beginning, how can they produce oxygen? How can they survive? So now the scholars have come around the view that initially, when the oxygen was not present, there were some anaerobic bacterias, that is those bacterias which could survive without oxygen. A large part of oxygen was initially released by these anaerobic bacteria. These bacteria, anaerobic means those bacteria which can survive without oxygen. These bacteria have released large part of oxygen, and certain primitive green plants, algae. Now these green plants also released oxygen, and they never required oxygen for the survival. Now it is accepted that 75% of the atmospheric oxygen is released by cyanobacteria, which is the anaerobic bacteria. Cyanobacteria, which is the anaerobic bacteria, and algae. These two are responsible for 75% of the oxygen that is found in the atmosphere. Now, this theory has been most acceptable, and basically to explain the origin of atmospheric oxygen. And this is how gradually the present composition of the atmosphere was achieved. Now, let us come on to the second part. This was the origin. Rest of the gases were being released from the cooling of the earth, and this oxygen has come to get formed in this fashion. Now, second part is, this is composition. Composition. Yes, any questions? See, if we see the composition, atmosphere comprises of, it is a mixture of gases. It is a mixture of gases, plus it also contains solid and liquid particles. These solid and liquid particles are collectively known as aerosols. These solid and liquid particles are collectively known as aerosols. So atmosphere is a mixture of gases, and it also contains solid and liquid particles, and these solid and liquid particles are collectively known as aerosols. Now, what we see in case of atmosphere, there are various gases found in the atmosphere, but the proportion of these gases is homogeneous in the lower part of the atmosphere, and this proportion is heterogeneous, not uniform, in the upper part. I will discuss it in detail. That is, the proportion of various gases remains constant in the lower atmosphere, that is known as homosphere. And the proportion of gases is not homogeneous in the upper part, so it is known as heterosphere. We'll discuss when we discuss the structure. Now what we see, the lower part of the atmosphere is having homogeneous composition, that the proportion of various gases is fixed, and the upper part of the atmosphere is having heterogeneous composition, that is the proportion of different gases keeps on changing. Now the most important gas that make up the atmosphere, that is nitrogen. Nitrogen comprises 78% of the atmospheric gases. Second most important gas is oxygen, 21%. Third is argon, 0.93%. Fourth is carbon dioxide, 0.03%. After this, the proportion of gases is very small, like neon in traces, helium, ozone, hydrogen. This is the decreasing proportion. Krypton, xenon, methane. So in terms of decreasing proportion, first maximum proportion nitrogen, then oxygen, then argon, then carbon dioxide, neon, helium, ozone, hydrogen, krypton, xenon, methane. Now these gases, individual gases, play a very important role. Nitrogen is basically chemically inactive. It does not enter into association. It does not enter into chemical union. So it is used as diluent. Because it does not enter into chemical union, it is inactive. Oxygen, as we all know, oxygen is basically required by all human beings for the survival. Argon, it is an inert gas, and inert gas basically is a very important because they are also almost unreactive. In tube lights and bulbs you use these inert gases. Carbon dioxide is again very important because it, apart from being an efficient absorber of heat, that is a very important greenhouse gas, it is also required by the plants for their photosynthesis. Now apart from these, basically what we see, ozone, this gas protects the earth from the dangerous, harmful ultraviolet radiation coming from the sun. Now apart from them, water vapor and apart from these gases, dust particle, they are also very important. Apart from this nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, ozone, this water vapor and dust particles are also very important. Water vapor is mostly present in the lower part of the atmosphere. That is, 90% of the water vapor is found up to 6 km and 99% of the water vapor is found up to 10 km. Water vapor is the source of all cloud and rainfall. This water vapor is the most important greenhouse gas. It is most efficient absorber of heat. So water vapor plays a very important role in maintaining the global temperature as well as formation of clouds and rainfall. Dust particle. Now these dust particles are very fine particles, solid particles, which are kept in suspension, mostly in the lower part of the atmosphere. These dust particles are very important for two purposes. First is scattering, and second is diffusion. In fact, third function also they perform, which is very important. That is, they act as hygroscopic nuclei. Dust particle basically by way of scattering, they are responsible of varied colors. Like red and orange color in the morning is because of scattering process. Basically the blue color of the sky is because of scattering process. They scatter the various wavelengths of the visible spectrum of the Vibhyor. Thus, dust particles scatter the various various wavelengths and basically thereby contribute to varied colors of the atmosphere. In the morning, red and yellow, red and orange during morning and evening is because of scattering. Blue color of the sky is because of scattering. Apart from this, this function of dust particles is even more important because it is because of diffusion that we have sufficient light even before the sunrise and after the sunset, what we call as dawn and twilight. The dawn and twilight are the result of diffusion by these dust particles. That we have sufficient light even before the sunrise and after the sunset. Hygroscopic nuclei, this function of dust particle enable the formation of cloud and fog. Because even if moisture is present in the air, it cannot condense until a surface is provided. So what happens in the absence of dust particle, the condensation cannot take place. So dust particle are the hygroscopic nuclei on which the condensation takes place. And it is the dust particle that enable the formation of cloud and fog. So this was the basically composition of atmosphere. Now structure. Let us come on to the main part, that is structure of atmosphere. See, atmosphere becomes rarefied as we move up. As we move up, the atmosphere goes on becoming rarefied. It has been found that 50% of the atmosphere is covered in the lower 5.6 km. It covers 50% of the atmosphere. This means, what do we mean by 50%? 50% means out of total atmospheric pressure, 50% of atmospheric pressure is exerted by the gases lying in the lower 5.6 km. If we take a barometer, then what we will see? At a height of 5.6 km, the atmospheric pressure is reduced to half. That is, lower atmosphere is having dense, it is dense gases. And as we move, the gases become rarefied. And this atmosphere is attached to the earth because of its gravitational force. So what happens? In the lower 5.6 km, this much thickness of atmosphere account for 50% of atmosphere. Because after 5.6 km height, the atmospheric pressure is reduced to half. It is found that when we rise to 16 km, we cover 90% of the atmosphere. That is, at a height of 16 km, the atmospheric pressure is just 10% of what we experience at the Earth's surface. And by 31 km, we cover 99% of the atmosphere. That means the atmospheric pressure at a height of 31 km is just 1%. But the outer limit of atmosphere is rather ambiguous. It is said the outermost limit of the atmosphere extends up to 32,000 km. This is based on the fact that as the earth is rotating, the atmosphere along with it is also rotating. As a result, a centrifugal force is acting on the atmosphere outward and gravitational force is acting towards the earth's center. It is this gravitational force that is holding the atmosphere. But as we move away, we reach a point where the outward directed centrifugal force will exceed the centerward directed gravitational force. Centrifugal force exceeds the Earth's gravitational force. So what we see at a height of 32,000 km, the centrifugal force exceeds the gravitational force. As a result, no more atmosphere can be held beyond that. On this premise, we believe that the outermost layer, outermost extent of atmosphere is 32,000 kilometers. Now, let us discuss the various layers of atmosphere.